Hello, my name is Blake Graham, and it is my pleasure to have here with us today Dr. Gerhard Schrauzer. Dr. Schrauzer is Professor Emeritus from the University of California in San Diego, where he taught for 27 years, and he is a graduate with a PhD from the University of Munich. He actually graduated summa cum laude and is one of the youngest PhDs ever from that university. Dr. Schrauzer is associated with many prestigious scientific and health organizations throughout the world, including a member of the American Institute of Nutrition, the American Association of Cancer Research, the Association of Clinical Scientists. You're a fellow of the American College of Nutrition, among many other accolades. You are the director also of your own biological trace element research laboratory and are the founder and editor-in-chief of a magazine by the same name, the Biological Trace Element Research magazine. I've seen a list of over 300 publications. I think there were 306 different publications that you have written for different journals. And I don't think that's all of them, is it?
That's not all of them, at least read in peer-reviewed journals.
And you're also an author and co-author of 6 different books.
That's right.
It's a pleasure to have you with us today, Dr. Schrauzer. Dr. Schrauzer, tell us a little bit about your background. Obviously, you've been interested in nutrition for a long time. Now, where were you born?
Yes, well, I was born actually in the middle of Europe in a famous Bohemian spa, which was founded in the 18th century and then frequented by royalty and famous people during the next centuries. It's called Franzensbad. It is about 30 miles east of another famous spa called Karlsbad, and it's about 20 miles north of another famous spa called Marienbad. These were wonderful centers of health, you might say, in the 19th century, where thousands of people were coming, and what did they do? They drank mineral waters for health. And this is what got me interested in trace elements at a very, very early age in my life, because we had a hotel. And many of our visitors wrote down in the guest book how much they were helped by taking minerals in these mineral waters. And because of after the war, I couldn't go to school, so I joined a research institute as a young boy, actually, at the age of 14, that did nothing but study trace minerals in mineral waters and soil. So this is how I got a first and very deep insight into both chemistry, trace elements, and health-related aspects, which remained with me all my life. And believe it or not, in my hometown was an area where plant-derived minerals, colloidal minerals, you could actually see how they form. And when I was just 16 years old, I analyzed colloidal minerals from that source, and found later that some colloidal mineral products, plant-derived minerals, have very similar composition. That gave me, of course, the contact with Dr. Joel Wallach, because Dr. Joel Wallach came to me, placed a bottle of plant-derived minerals on my desk and said, I want you to analyze this. And then I realized I had done this years before as a young man, and these solutions were actually quite similar chemically.
What are some of the unique chemical characteristics of plant-derived minerals?
Well, it is the combination of the elements and some of the additional substances that are present, basically sulfur compounds, which are making them so very unusual and healthful. And that's why we are seeing such wonderful effects. Many people report astonishing improvements of their health. Nothing helped, for example, against a bad back. Then they drink plant-derived minerals, and relatively in a short time, they are much better. Now, medical science would frown upon such stories, and I was skeptical too myself, but I had problems with my back. And believe it or not, if I'm permitted to tell this testimonial here, it helped me so fantastically that today I can carry any kind of luggage unsymmetrically with one hand or the other, and I haven't had any back problems since. And believe me, nothing else really helped before that. And we know now why this is actually, why this helps through the research I've done with the plant-derived minerals. It has to do with the sulfur content and the other minerals that are present, that the body is able to produce chondroitin sulfate, which is a rubber-like polymer, which helps the spine to remain rigid under stress. And obviously, when you get older, you may not produce chondroitin sulfate polymers rapidly enough, and then you get slip discs and all kinds of problems with your back. So this is a very brief, the biochemical basis of some of the effects of the plant-derived minerals. These are not all, but some of them are very important. And that explains what always puzzled me, why so many people said it would help them so much with their back problem.
You mentioned the sulfur compounds. Is that what gives many plant-derived minerals the astringent, bitter taste?
That is also true, yes. That and some of the minerals present, iron and aluminum and so forth, yes.
Recently, you've been involved in a historic movement to get the FDA, the Food and Drug Administration in America, to recognize some of the benefits of a particular trace mineral we know as selenium.
Yes, if I may say so, the FDA does not allow that anyone could make a health claim about anything. You couldn't say, for example, that selenium helps against certain forms of cancer, unless you could prove it. They demand sufficient scientific evidence. So on the recommendations of Dr. Wallach, we accumulated approximately 500 scientific papers and submitted them to the FDA, and we were able to get the approval for two health claims. The first one is that selenium can reduce the risk of certain forms of cancer. And the second is that selenium produces anti-cancer substances in the human organism. And this is a quite significant achievement, and it's purely altruistic also, because other companies may use this kind of information. But at least now we can help people recognize the value of selenium. And I think this is most important because the intake of selenium in many populations is insufficient to maximize its protective effects.
Tell us a little bit about that, Dr. Schrauzer. Tell us about the selenium levels in the various countries that you've seen research from or done research in yourself.
That's right. You see, selenium works on many different physiological levels. And one level, for example, is an enzyme called glutathione peroxidase. And that is an enzyme that prevents the accumulation of hydrogen peroxide and of lipid hydroperoxides, that is basically oxidized fatty substances, in our organism. Now, these substances, lipid hydroperoxides and hydrogen peroxides, have the nasty habit that they can decompose, forming very, very destructive oxygen radicals, so-called hydroxyl radicals. And these hydroxyl radicals will attack anything. Proteins, it will attack fats, it will attack even DNA. And the latter damage is, of course, the most serious ones, because if you get damaged DNA, you get mutations and ultimately even help in the progression of a normal cell into a cancer cell. And that's why people have measured glutathione peroxidase in the blood, and they determined the amount of selenium that we need on the activity of glutathione peroxidase in our plasma. And on the basis of that, they derived certain recommended dietary allowances. However, we have found that this is not sufficient, that selenium, there are in fact 23, or by now even 25, other selenoenzymes in the body. And some of them become activated only at relatively higher dosages. And so in determining the RDA for selenium, glutathione peroxidase is now recognized as not being sufficient. You have to think of other enzymes, and one of them are the so-called thioredoxin reductases. Now, sounds very chemical. What it is that there are certain small molecules that contain sulfur, and they can be oxidized and reduced, small proteins, and they're called the thioredoxins. And they are very important in the transfer of electrons within the cell and within organs. And when this process doesn't work very well, then you can imagine there's havoc in the entire organism. And one enzyme, the so-called the thioredoxin reductase, will catalyze the reduction of oxidized thioredoxins back into their active reduced form. And that is a selenium-dependent enzyme, and that becomes activated only at significantly higher selenium intakes than recommended now based on glutathione peroxidase alone.
So you're saying that we have a lot of free radical damage. That's kind of like rust of our cells, like just as iron rusts, or you see an apple that starts to turn brown, that same kind of activity can happen in our cells. And one of the things that helps prevent that is there's actually an enzyme that our body produces that requires selenium. And that selenium enzyme helps prevent that. And there's a certain level that the government has recognized in most countries that we need a certain amount of level of selenium for this one enzyme. But you're saying that there's actually 23 to 25 different enzymes that use selenium, so we actually need a lot more.
You see, these recommendations were made before some of these enzymes were actually discovered. And because there's a certain inertia with all these agencies, they don't meet every year and they don't want to change their recommendations all the time. So now we know that there's this other enzyme, at least, the thioredoxin reductase, and that one is a so-called inducible enzyme. In fact, it becomes active only at higher levels, at levels at which glutathione peroxidase is already maximized. Thioredoxin reductase may be still low. And so you can increase the selenium intake and up goes the thioredoxin reductase activity. And that is why leading scientists, among myself, now say we need significantly more selenium than just for glutathione peroxidase. The result is that whereas the recommended dietary allowances are now at around 50 to 55 micrograms per day, we are actually saying the human body needs 300 to 350 micrograms per day. And this is actually recognized by our governmental agencies. This is considered the maximum safe selenium intake. So they acknowledge, yes, you can have higher dosages of selenium every day. And 350, we say to be absolutely safe, conservative at the same time, is around 350, right? And so this is why I'm recommending, and this goes back to our work on cancer, that our selenium intake should in fact reach that level of 300 to 350 micrograms a day. Why do I know this? Well, we actually collected blood from many countries, and then we discovered that in populations where certain cancers like breast cancer, lung cancer, prostate cancer, and colon cancer is low, they all had quite nice selenium levels in their blood, which were proportional to the selenium intakes and which brought their selenium index in the order of 300 to 350 micrograms a day. Whereas in countries where you had just 50 to 100 micrograms per day of selenium, these types of cancer were invariably quite high.
Let's talk about two of those countries in specific. Let's talk about Australia and Japan. What are the daily intake of selenium that people get in their diets in Australia versus Japan and the corresponding cancer rates in those two countries?
We actually went to Japan and got blood samples and found that the Japanese have very nice blood selenium levels ranging between 0.27 and 0.30 micrograms per cubic centimeter, whereas in Australia it's only 0.13, which is only about one-third of that. And this corresponds to selenium intakes for, let's say, an average adult of 70 kilograms in Japan of about 300 micrograms per day, whereas in Australia only about 100 micrograms per day. Now, mind you, 100 micrograms a day will not give overt signs what scientists would call selenium deficiency syndrome, and we'll talk about these later. So clinically, they may at the moment look healthy, because they have enough to saturate glutathione peroxidase activity, but they don't have enough for other protective functions of selenium, and that brings us into the cancer range. You see, selenium protects against cancer by many different mechanisms. One is, for instance, the immune system, and the immune system requires more selenium. It requires about 200 to 300 micrograms a day. Why do I know this? I know this because they've done studies. In some patients that need artificial nutrition, intravenous nutrition, they add selenium to the mixture, but only about 50 micrograms, which would be about the RDA. And these people had very low antibody production against common antigens. And that is very important. When these people were given 200 micrograms extra selenium, their antibody production increased up to tenfold. So there you have already one example that the recommended dietary allowances were limited to only one parameter, glutathione peroxidase, and they totally ignored the immune system. Why was that? Well, because at the time all these regulations were made, people were not all that interested in the immune system. But we now know, of course, much more about the immune system. We know, for example, that we have cells that destroy foreign invaders, bacteria and viruses. These are the so-called cytotoxic cells derived from the specialized white blood cells. Now, these produce oxygen radicals to destroy invaders and other tumor cells. But they have to have enough selenium to do this well, or else they destroy themselves. And so studies have shown if you give people additional selenium, their cytotoxic cells can destroy up to 5 times more tumor cells than those who just get the normal RDI of selenium.
So when you're saying additional selenium, how much additional are we talking? They get some selenium in their diet, and then they supplement with additional selenium.
That's right, and I think it's a good thing to now say we need about 200 to 300 micrograms extra. We don't really need more. And that brings us into the level of the maximum safe intake that is recommended by the Institute of Nutrition and other agencies. So now that shows you that our recommendation is ethical. In other words, you don't have to worry about toxicity. It's well proven that this produces no unsafe levels whatsoever for the entire lifespan, right? And doesn't adversely affect any physiological function. Of course, you will wonder how toxic is selenium, and many people still think selenium is a poison. Historically, this is because selenium became known as a poison for the first time in the 20s in the United States. There are some high selenium regions, and when they had cattle grazing in these regions, they developed diseases attributed to selenium toxicity. For example, horses would lose their hooves, and farmers were, of course, terribly alarmed, you know, poisonous soil, poisonous plants, and then they found it is selenium. And the U.S. Department of Agriculture did extensive studies in these regions to find out how they were located and especially also whether they would do damage to humans. So I can say that selenium, from the toxicological point of view, is probably the best investigated trace element ever. But they found no evidence in these high selenium regions, South Dakota is one, New Mexico, of any damage to human health. So the unfortunate image of selenium as a poison was only for animals, not for humans. But this carried on over the years. And when my friend Klaus Schwartz showed 1957 that selenium was an essential trace element, initially people threw up their arms and said, my God, selenium, the poison, suddenly needed by the human organism. And so for a while it was called the essential poison. We now know, of course, that all elements are basically safe at a certain level and become toxic at a higher level. This is true even for water. Too much water can kill you. Too much oxygen can kill you. So we shouldn't worry about this as long as we know the safe window.
Isn't it true that the safety issue is also affected by some balancing nutrients? They think with selenium, zinc and copper in there help people to achieve the balance in their bodies with higher levels of selenium.
That is right. And the physiological effects of selenium also depend on how much protein you eat. If you give experimental animals a high selenium diet, they would be toxic under normal condition. You can abolish the toxicity if your protein intake is also increased, protein intake of these animals. So it is a balance also between the sulfur amino acids in the food and selenium. And that's why, you know, all the concerns about selenium toxicity are really unwarranted. Selenium has an excellent safety record, in fact, and practically nobody was ever seriously poisoned.
Well, you've also been a visiting professor twice in China and twice in Japan. Tell us about some of the research on selenium that's come out of those areas.
Yes, I was especially interested in another selenium deficiency disease. We know the Chinese discovered Kashan disease, which is a cardiomyopathy, and we will talk a little bit more about that. But then there's another one, the so-called Cushing-Beck syndrome, in which children cease growing because the actively growing part of the bone is atrophied and stops growing. And so they remain dwarfs. And when you visit some of the regions in Xi'an, you still see patients sitting in corners, small dwarfs that have Cushing-Beck syndrome. Research showed that selenium can prevent significantly the Cushing-Beck syndrome. And I went there and we did some research and we found that some additional elements play a role in this disease as well. The deficiency, for example, in iodine, boron, very interestingly, which we know also helps bone formation. And then, interestingly enough, a highly neglected element, germanium, which is in some of the colloidal plant-derived minerals also. So here you have example of synergistic interactions. It is not selenium alone. It is important. You've got to watch the other ones too, and they have to be given in the diet as well.
Tell us about some of the conditions that you've seen selenium help with. I know you've talked about bleeding fevers.
Yes, hemorrhagic fever, which is a terrible disease with an extremely high mortality, 80% mortality. And that also occurs in some parts of China, and it has a viral origin. And these people basically bleed to death. And there was a Chinese doctor during an epidemic of hemorrhagic fever who decided you've got to do something about it. These people were dying. So he gave these people selenium at relatively high dosages. And he could actually lower the mortality from 80% in the acute phase of the disease to about 20%. It's a tremendous success. Some of this wonderful Chinese research goes completely unnoticed in the West, and this is why I actually created a special award for such researchers, the Klaus Schwarz Award, and the doctor's name was Dr. Hu, H-O-U, and he was a recipient of that medal.
You've also seen benefits of selenium with teeth and even eyesight, I've heard.
That's right. We've done studies in patients and gave them selenium, and then by questionnaire, the 80% or so reported improvements of their vision. And you see, the eye has very high selenium concentrations. And in fact, as comparative studies have shown that in animals, the better an animal can see, the higher its selenium content is. And for instance, cats have very high, they have very good eyes, and the selenium content in the eye is very high. And so, yes, it is very, very important for our vision. In the case of teeth, the dentine is a sort of protein which is sulfur-rich, and it requires selenium to be formed properly. And so selenium is one of these so-called anti-cariogenic trace elements. It prevents caries. And a striking proof of this was a comparative study of the teeth of antique Greeks. They had perfect teeth. No cavities, nothing. Compared to modern Athenians, they have shocking teeth with a lot of caries. And they showed that the antique Greeks had three times more selenium in their dentine than the present-day Greeks. Now you will say, why is that? Well, it has to do with dietary changes. They eat much more sugar now. The sugar was unknown as such in antiquity. And they eat more grains, and it's simply a healthier diet at that time, which gave them automatically more selenium. So it's an anti-cariogenic agent. Now let's go down in the body into the thyroid. Selenium is needed for the proper function of the thyroid. And why is that? We have these thyroid hormones, and they are inactive forms. They're called T4. That's the molecule that has four iodines in it. Tyrosine amino acid is four iodine. And that has to be converted to T3 with only three iodines. And there's an enzyme which does that. And that enzyme requires selenium. So it now happens, and they discovered that some people may have abnormal thyroid hormone production. They cannot somehow produce T3. And they didn't know how this came about until they found that these people needed additional selenium to produce enough of that enzyme to affect this deiodization. So now let's go down even further. Let's go to the heart, as we all agree, a very important organ. And the heart cells contract rhythmically. That's the marvel, the miracle of the heart cells. And this contractile function requires selenium. So normally the heart should be rich in selenium. If you make the heart low in selenium, you develop cardiomyopathy, which can be fatal. May I tell you now a personal story, which I haven't told you yet, or seldom anyone. So as I told you, I was born there in the center of Europe, And at that time, they didn't know that it was a selenium deficiency region. There was something peculiar in my youth. I couldn't run very well. I always had trouble running. And when I then went to Germany, joined the university, we had to have a medical exam. And we got an x-ray, and suddenly all these medics called all the physicians, "Look at this guy. He has a so-called athlete's heart." At that time, people called anyone with an enlarged heart an athlete's heart, because they saw it often in people who exercise a lot. I didn't do much exercise. I told you I couldn't run very well. I actually had the beginnings of Keshan disease. And by taking selenium, my heart has normalized in size, because it turns out my hometown is in the low selenium region. And that brings me what I mentioned before to the very important effect of selenium and viruses. They couldn't quite work out why some of the children in the Keshan diseases died while others did not, until they found out that in the heart of most people are actually viruses, which are normally benign, so-called Coxsackie viruses. There are at least 7 different variants of these viruses, and they are what we call cardiophilic viruses. They will lodge specifically in the heart. They won't do you much harm or any harm. But if your selenium intake is low, then we know that you get more oxygen radical production. Now, these oxygen radicals will not only damage your heart cell, they will also damage the virus, the Coxsackie virus. And what was a benign, non-pathogenic virus will suddenly become virulent and destroy the heart.
So is that why there's a lot of doctors now, when somebody has a heart disease, they say you've got a bacteria or a virus lodged in your heart? You know, you pick that up somewhere. It was actually there all the time.
It was all the time.
It's a selenium deficiency that triggered.
Exactly. It triggered it. And it can also be triggered by other environmental influences. For example, they found in Germany that people who were exposed to mercury had a higher incidence of cardiomyopathy. How is that possible? Well, selenium will react with mercury in the body. Mercury inactivates the necessary enzymes. So again, we are going back to selenium here. So this is the great story of selenium in the heart. And so Keshan disease is not a pure selenium deficiency, but it also has to do with viruses. And that brings us now to the absolutely wonderful effect of selenium against viruses. The studies were done by Melinda Beck, an American researcher, and she now has also found this is true for influenza virus. That means there are different forms of influenza virus which differ in how much damage they do. And she showed that in selenium deficiency, a mildly active influenza virus would become more virulent. So selenium is, in fact, also a natural antiviral agent. And that even is true for the AIDS virus. And there are now in the United States studies that show or are in the process of looking at the effects of selenium in AIDS patients.
Now, those studies involve much higher levels of selenium than even we've been talking about. Isn't it much beyond even the 300?
No, not necessarily. They're still physiological. And, you know, we did research with AIDS patients years ago because I, in fact, was the first one who recommended selenium supplementation to AIDS patients. And, in fact, this has been subsequently studied, and we did this ourselves, and we found symptomatic improvement of AIDS patients with selenium. For instance, the French have shown that the cardiomyopathy of AIDS patients can be alleviated by giving them selenium. And Dr. Montagnier, one of the co-discoverers of the AIDS virus, he actually also always recommended something has to be done against the oxygen radical production in HIV-infected subjects, because that increases the pathogenicity of that virus. So, selenium and viruses, who would have thought that suddenly? But always, you see, it's again the higher dosage level that we need optimally for protection. Selenium is not just a trace element that is essential. It also has protective functions, and for that you need more. In other words, you need a little reserve. Okay, let's go down to the liver. Also, as we all will agree, a very important organ. And the liver also should be normally rich in selenium. And in fact, animal studies have shown that a healthy animal will have high levels of selenium in the liver. And in fact, when one of the first studies that was done by Klaus Schwartz, when he made experimentally low selenium diets, when he fed those to rats, these rats would develop within 2 weeks, young rats, a fatal liver necrosis. In other words, the liver would simply die. And that actually led to the discovery of the essentiality of selenium. And it happens sometimes in humans. I myself once was asked to help in a case of a serious alcoholic. He had no detectable levels of selenium in his blood, and he had a very severely damaged liver, so he was given large doses of selenium, and he had a very, very remarkable recovery.
I've noticed with my own mother that she had a lot of liver spots, and when she started supplementing with extra selenium with the rest of the 90 essential nutrients, that those liver spots on her face all faded away and started disappearing from her arms and the back of her hands as well.
That's a very good point. What are these liver spots? They're caused by basically oxidized fat, and they are called lipofuscin. And this is caused by oxygen radical production. If you then give selenium, after a while these oxygen radicals no longer produce and the spots will disappear. So the skin, in other words, requires selenium. And that, of course, also has to do, now if you add to this the immune system, can there be any wonder that selenium is a protecting agent against certain forms of cancer? This becomes quite clear now.
Tell us a little bit about the Schrauzer Award. You've got a special award out now for people who do research on selenium. Tell us a little bit about what that represents and some of the studies that have come out from people that you've awarded this to.
Right. Well, actually, there's another of these stories of mine, which I haven't yet told very much. I once was invited to Germany to talk to former cancer patients. You know, there's these self-help organizations. And I arrived there late in the evening. And before I left my hotel in Switzerland, and I had some selenium supplements on my desk, put it in my trouser pocket. And I came to this place where these women were all aggregating, and it was Friday night. Suddenly the door opens and the woman comes in, and she had lymphedema of the arm, and it was swollen.
What is lymphedema?
Well, you see, people who had breast cancer sometimes get all the lymph nodes of the arm and the axilla taken out. And then they may develop a stagnation of lymph in their arm, and their arm will swell up, become quite hard. And these arms are very sensitive to infections, and this is called lymphedema. Most women are being told, well, you have to live with it, it's better than to die from breast cancer, and there's nothing we can do. But these poor women have to watch very carefully whether their arm gets infected, and oftentimes they have to wear gloves all the time to do their work. And can you imagine, if a woman has her right hand with which she has to do work, she must avoid any form of injury, or else she would get erysipelas infection, which can be very dangerous. It's a very unpleasant condition. And on this evening, a woman came and had a swollen arm, which was seriously inflamed, and she was in pain, and blisters formed on it. She passed my table, and I simply integrated all my biochemical knowledge. I said, sit down, reached in my pocket, gave her the selenium, and she took that selenium, 800 micrograms, I still remember today. And then she was sitting at our table, and we could actually, within 40 minutes or so, see how the inflammation disappeared and how the swelling went down. Then within 12 hours, the total swelling of the arm was very, very significantly reduced practically to normal. So we were, of course, excited. And then, since there were so many women there with lymphedema, we did a study with 86 of these women and could confirm, yes, it works. And it's now an accepted therapy in Europe for lymphedema.
Did it work on all 86?
It works in a large percentage of these patients. Of course, you have some patients who had lymphedema for many years, decades, and then it hardens, they get calcium deposits. But even there, after longer dosages of selenium, we could still achieve a softening even of old resistant lymphedema.
So it seemed to help everyone.
It was certainly positive. And then, in the meantime, large scale in clinical studies were done in some clinics. And one of the key results was that selenium does prevent the infections. And so they don't have to take antibiotics anymore. And this is, of course, a great achievement. And for this, I received a reward. That brought me the idea that selenium must have many, many functions in other diseases associated with inflammation. And so I first recommended to use selenium in acute pancreatitis, which is another fatal disease. If you have acute pancreatitis, you're in big trouble. And selenium does significantly reduce the mortality from acute pancreatitis. Then the next very fatal condition is septicemia. And medical doctors in Europe have shown, in fact, that selenium reduces the mortality from septicemia, especially if accompanied by pneumonia. Now, this is, of course, an achievement because basically once you have septicemia and pneumonia, you better have written your will, my friend. But again, a significant mortality reduction was achieved. So suddenly all these terrible conditions became treatable. And so a company that produces selenium drugs decided we have to improve the knowledge of physicians in selenium and stimulate the use in acute medicine. And therefore they said, because in honor of me, they would nominate people for the Schrauzer Award if they came up with similar usages of selenium as I did. Last year in July in Berlin, we actually gave away the first Schrauzer Award to Dr. Savas Khan, who discovered another very important thing, and that is that selenium can reduce the neurological damage subsequent to stroke. Now, you know very well that stroke is a rather terrible thing to have, but even worse is the subsequent damage of the brain cells. It leads to these often permanent effects of stroke.
The paralyzation.
That's right. And this is caused by oxygen radical damage to the neuron, and one can reduce that damage by selenium. So this is, again, another example of how selenium works. It's a true miracle element. And we haven't seen the rest of it yet. There are many things to come. The story of selenium goes on like I've never seen with any other trace element. Usually, when something like that is reported, they have an initial increase of research papers. Well, and then, you know, it stops. But in the case of selenium, in the past 30 years, it goes on and on and on. It becomes more exciting almost every week.
How much selenium were they using? What kind of dosage?
Well, in acute cases, you have to use a little more, and they give about 1,000 micrograms intravenously often because seriously ill patients cannot swallow. Germany is leading in this application of selenium, I have to say, yes,
How much selenium do you personally use?
Well, you know, going back to our real interest in selenium as a nutritional, what you have to do is always make sure that you have a healthy reserve of selenium in your body, in your liver, in your heart, and elsewhere. And therefore, 300 micrograms to 400 micrograms a day, this is how much I'm taking. Now for 30 years, 30.
Now, there are some other nutrients that help with the effects of selenium, some synergistic nutrients.
That's right.
What are some of those?
Well, vitamin E, for example, is a well-known synergistic nutrient because you can argue, you see, if selenium doesn't catch all the hydroperoxides, you can still form some oxygen radicals, which are then snatched by vitamin E. And so vitamin E can actually reduce the requirement for selenium, right? You can use less selenium if you have vitamin E, which so there you have a synergistic effect between selenium and vitamin E. Then synergistic effects between selenium and iodine, thyroid hormones, the proper functioning of the thyroid, you need selenium and iodine. The synergistic effects between selenium and copper, some synergism between selenium and zinc.
For best results, people should be using selenium and the rest of the 90 essential nutrients?
For general maintenance, just to maintain optimal health, all nutrients are necessary. That's probably the best advice I can give you, because giving an isolated nutrient is, in a way, not right. For example, people have shown if you give people too much just magnesium, you get into trouble with copper, for example. You can induce a copper deficiency or also reduce the iron. So there has to be a proper balance. Also calcium and magnesium should be given, not just calcium. The body maintains a pretty sharp ratio between calcium and magnesium.
The same thing, I think, is true of iron and copper.
Yes, you're right. You see, there are people who, for some reason, had iron deficiency anemia, and giving them iron alone didn't help. But giving them some copper suddenly improved their condition. Why? Because copper is needed for proper iron utilization.
Is there a difference in the form of selenium? Is an inorganic form versus a chelated form versus something from a plant? Is there a difference in how the body utilizes it?
Yes, there is a difference, and I think this is a very good question because, first of all, we are talking about nutrition. What is the major nutritional form of selenium? See, plants don't need, at least this is our present knowledge, don't need selenium for growth. They basically absorb it from the soil altruistically to help animals and humans. Actually an amazing phenomenon. In other words, even at very low selenium soils, you still get grass growing, but the forage crops on selenium poor soils are not healthy for the animals, and this is how it was discovered that white muscle disease in lambs, for example, would erupt. This form of selenium that is in the grass is not inorganic. It's in the protein of the plant, and it's in the form primarily of an amino acid, selenomethionine. So it turns out that, in fact, the key nutritional form of selenium is organic and selenomethionine. What does selenomethionine do? It's the only amino acid, and I cannot emphasize this enough, which can replace another amino acid in our body, methionine. And therefore, selenium can be stored in the organism. Our muscles, which contain up to 40% of the total amount of selenium in the body, contain selenium in the form of selenomethionine. And this is important because if you give selenite to animals or humans, the body cannot make selenomethionine, and therefore you cannot get that selenium into the muscles. And that's why it's so very, very important to have an organic form of selenium in the form of selenomethionine. And therefore we should not, when they say chelated selenium, it's already not the same because the body cannot make selenomethionine. So this is a nutritional form. There are, however, therapeutic form. If you have, you know, this is not the purpose here of our discussion to talk too much about therapy, but selenite has been used and is being used in medicine and animal husbandry as a rapid form of selenium that is infused or given to prevent conditions. So, yes, you can use sodium selenite for therapy if you need rapid effects, like I used for the lymphedema. If someone has an inflamed condition, you cannot give a nutrient and expect rapid result because it first has to be metabolized. You have to do something other and you give selenite. But for nutritional supplementation, as we understand it, selenomethionine is the form of selenium that should be given. And that was correctly recognized by the people who did the large-scale cancer prevention study, Larry Clark. They gave selenium in the form of selenomethionine as it is found in yeast. And in this regard, the study, it was very important because it was a nutritional cancer prevention study. And so one should check always the label. Is it in the form of selenomethionine? Yes, then it is the nutritional form.
If somebody is taking selenium supplements, you mentioned that they first have to be metabolized. Would taking enzymes help?
Yes, in fact, vitamin B6 will help. Enzymes dependent on vitamin B6 will help to metabolize selenomethionine into the biologically active form.
You mentioned that we store a large part of our selenium, 40%, in our muscles. I have heard people that use selenium before they work out and after they work out, and they don't have as much of the sore muscles afterwards.
When I see some of these joggers and when I see how they massage their leg muscles, I always have to snigger because, you know, I told you I'm taking selenium now for many years. Muscle pain was something I experienced after exercise. Ever since I took selenium, I don't even know what that is, muscle pain or muscle stiffness.
Are there other nutrients that help with that as well? I've heard about calcium and muscle cramps and leg cramps.
Yes, well, that is something true. Calcium, magnesium help, and that is also very important.
In talking about nutrition, a lot of people have encouraged people to take mega doses of a single nutrient, but in your experience, even experience with the world-renowned Dr. Linus Pauling,
yes,
that it's much better to take a broad spectrum of nutrition, and sometimes taking mega doses of one can throw off your balances in other nutrients. Isn't that correct?
Exactly, and this is especially true for vitamin C, which is now, you know, one of the most popular vitamins ever. And many people take, in my opinion, too much vitamin C. Because if you take high doses of vitamin C, it causes a loss of copper. And that is very important because you can develop aneurysm, which can be fatal. And so this is one reason why I'm against mega-dosing vitamin C. Also, for another reason, when you take large doses of vitamin C, the body learns to adapt to this situation and excretes it more rapidly. If you then stop, the body, in fact, will continue to deplete the organism of vitamin C, and you can get to very dangerously low levels. That's the so-called rebound effect. And lastly, I'm against vitamin C overdosage, and we've done that study actually in San Diego. Vitamin C is a reducing agent. It uses up oxygen, right? Now you need oxygen. Who will deny that? And there were studies before World War II where they tested fighter pilots. And these fighter pilots didn't have any pressurized cabins. And they noticed that if they took some vitamin C, their high altitude resistance would improve. But if they took too much of it, it would get much worse. And this was repeated. And it indeed showed that guinea pigs given too much vitamin C had very low high altitude simulated oxygen depletion resistance. And we repeated this with American fighter pilots in San Diego at the Naval Air Base. And we could show that those who had the worst high altitude resistance was after dosage of high doses of vitamin C. So this is another reason why I said, let's do this.
You talked with Dr. Linus Pauling about that. Did you see any of those effects in him personally?
Yes, I knew Linus Pauling very well, of course. And like so many who take high doses of vitamin C, it causes your skin to become very pale because it interferes with the melanin production, which requires a copper-dependent enzyme. And so high doses of vitamin C, we cannot recommend.
I know you've associated with a lot of very prestigious scientists around the world. You've actually been listed as one of the top 10 most quoted scientists in the entire world. What do you feel about your association with Dr. Wallach? Tell us a little bit about how you met him and how you feel about some of the research that he has done.
Well, you know, Joel Wallach became known to me from the press in 1978 when he announced that he discovered the first animal model of cystic fibrosis in a rhesus monkey. And that was a wonderful achievement because cystic fibrosis is quite common in the human population. And, you know, people say, yes, when they really don't know what something is caused by, they say it's genetic, right? And to this day, we haven't really gotten a handle on cystic fibrosis because we didn't have an animal model to create conditions related to cystic fibrosis, which involves, by the way, pancreatic atrophy. It was Dr. Joel Wallach who actually developed a rhesus monkey model of cystic fibrosis. And when he announced this, he said that this discovery is relevant to human cystic fibrosis. And some of the old hands in cystic fibrosis research said, what? How can he possibly say that selenium and vitamin E deficiency would be causing cystic fibrosis? Cystic fibrosis is a genetic disease. There's nothing you can do about it. And poor Dr. Wallach lost his job at the Yerkes Primate Research Center. And when I read this in the American press, I got so furious. And I thought to myself, this is so terrible that someone is being fired for proposing something, for voicing an idea, which in this case was even supported by an experiment. At that time, I was organizing an international conference at the University of California, and I invited Dr. Wallach to give a talk, and I still remember we invited really the cream of the crop of trace element research in the world. It was 1979, and Dr. Wallach gave an extremely well-received lecture on his theory of cystic fibrosis. And this helped him greatly, in fact, to overcome the stigma of having been, you know, openly dismissed. And since then, we became the best of friends, and it's a wonderful collaboration that has developed. So 25 years of happy friendship, really. And if you add now my previous interest in colloidal minerals and work, it makes it almost an unbelievable coincidence that the two of us have met. Somehow we were placed together to work together, and if I use haste.
Well, Dr. Schrauzer, just to conclude this message, we've heard a lot of the research that you've shared with us that you've come across. Why isn't the public aware of this? Why don't more doctors publish these and the medical community make a bigger deal about it?
Yes, well, this is a very difficult question to answer. Why is that? Because it takes surprisingly long before a message sinks in into the medical community. Take cardiomyopathy. Usually, doctors see patients much too late. In other words, when they're already dying of cardiomyopathy, then they have to do all kinds of things, including surgery or whatever. Therefore, they're not really interested in nutrition. They say, why should I consider nutrition? These patients are dying. I have to do surgery, for example. And so when you tell them, hey, why don't you give them selenium? They never see patients before they develop the cardiomyopathy, which may take years. And I think this is the real issue at the core of this situation, that medical doctors see everybody far too late. Chronic diseases require many years before they actually become manifest. And this is where nutrition comes in, and this is where I think the recommendation of taking selenium and other minerals becomes so important, because we have to tell healthy people before any sign of disease is noticeable, take your selenium, take your minerals, take them now. And you will not ever land in the heart clinic with cardiomyopathy, right? So we use all the protective properties of minerals in time, as they do in veterinary medicine already for you.
So I think part of our message today is not only for people to supplement with selenium, but to help us take this message to other people as well, because the medical community is not doing it.
Absolutely. It's like talking to the wrong agency, right? You're talking to the water agency about your gas stove. They will say, well, you're a nice guy, we like you, but we have nothing to do with gas stoves. And the same thing, I believe, is ultimately, if you go to a practicing doctor and you say, what can I do about cardiomyopathy? Well, what can he tell you? He's not a nutritionist. He has his hands full to do with acute cases. And so he will say, well, I don't know, or don't do anything. And this is where we come in. We can say, no, 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 with good nutrition and mineral supplementation, you will never get these conditions.
Do you have any last experiences that you would like to share with us?
Well, I already mentioned, for instance, that muscular pain has completely disappeared. I never have it, but maybe I should throw that one in. I was a little nearsighted in my 30s, and I often had to sit in the front row during lectures so I could see and read the slides. And I was afraid, you know, in California we have to take driver's license examinations every 3 years, and they test your eyes, and they would have said, Gerhard, you need glasses. And so when I took selenium, suddenly my eyesight improved so much that all these problems disappeared, and they remain so today. I don't need glasses. And I have subsequently talked to many people who take selenium, and many of them say the same thing, that their eyesight improved. And our studies with the lymphedema patients show the same thing.
What about mood?
Yes, and that is also important. You know, the brain needs selenium. And in fact, selenomethionine specifically goes into the brain. So this is a very important fact, and I'm glad you brought that up, because studies have shown if you put humans on a low selenium diet, they become depressed. And if you give them selenium, their mood stabilizes, their depression is gone. So it is absolutely essential for brain function, and it helps you with mood. And we've seen that also in our studies with the HIV-infected patient. They reported, hey, I'm no longer depressed.
What about for children? Is selenium important for children?
Absolutely. And you see, this is one of my great concerns, because during the first 4 or 5 months in life of babies, their blood selenium levels go down often to very, very low levels. Almost, you know, acute deficiency levels, and then they increase slowly. But this is true for European, or you could say Western and Australian children. Interestingly enough, it's not true for Japanese children. There, the selenium levels are high to begin with and never show that initial decline. So from this, I judge that indeed our selenium supply is dangerously low, because children should never go through a period where their selenium levels in the blood is very low. It should always be high to begin with, so that they can really utilize the protective functions of selenium through every period in their life.
Is that one of the reasons you see a lot of ear infections in small children?
Well, it's well known. They say the immune system has not yet matured and all that sort of thing, but we know, my friend, without selenium, your immune system does not work. Selenium is required for all functions of the immune system. I cannot emphasize this enough. And unfortunately, in pediatric nutrition, selenium is, in my opinion, grossly underestimated and neglected.
So if an adult is taking 300 to 400 micrograms a day, how much would you have an infant?
Well, in infants, there are some recommendations. 20 micrograms a day is probably okay. I would, however, say that if it is the nutritional form of selenium, first of all, there's not much danger of toxicity anyway. So 20 to 50 micrograms for children per day would be perfect, right? And then especially, I think, of teenagers, what they need. They grow rapidly, and they're like adults. And don't forget, our weight has increased over the last 3 decades. Many of our discussions are dealing with average weights, yet the RDAs are not really specifying the weight of the subjects. Muhammad Ali and Michael Jackson have the same selenium requirement. Ridiculous. A heavy man must need more selenium, right?
What about expecting mothers?
Absolutely essential. And again, veterinary medicine has shown this to be true, because selenium is the key element guaranteeing the healthy birthing of calves, for example. And also it reduces the incidence of placental retention, which is a very unpleasant thing to happen, very costly, because these animals must be treated. Placental retention also occurs in humans, my friend, and you can prevent it with selenium. So women in pregnancy require selenium, yes, well, 200, 300 micrograms a day. Very, very important.
Thank you very much for your time today, Dr. Schrauzer. We look forward to hearing from you again.
Thank you.